Everyone, I'm Nemo. I studied at IIoT, where we have this cool thing called SE Labs, where you teach a lot of people how to code. So this is a talk that I've given previously in March this year, and I've updated the talk slightly, few changes. So the idea of this talk is to teach you little bits of lots of different things. Okay, so when you're starting as a software developer, you might think, okay, I'm going to do web development. Okay, and then you're surrounded with things like, okay, should I go and learn Django? Should I go and learn Rails? Or should I just write my own framework? Should I learn PHP? Should I learn Laravel? And then 1,000 different things. And that's just web development. If you start thinking about more things, like let's say pick up Android, and now there's iOS, and now people are saying, okay, let's go to Firefox OS. Okay, and now you have a novel list of applications, and software developers turns out to be a really, really big field. Okay, and the idea of this talk is to teach you something that I call, okay, I'll try to stick to the slides. So, this is what the CSE course structure in Burnish looks like. This is the thing that we're taught. I'm not a CSE graduate, I studied production industrial engineering, which is completely irrelevant. You know, operating system algorithms, and this is what companies ask for. These are the prerequisites. You can't even apply if you don't know these things, but if you know, you're supposed to expect me to also understand these things properly. Okay, so they ask me for things like web applications, which I never taught in college. They ask for things like databases, distributed system, machine learning, never taught in college. So as it turns out, there's a complete, you know, disconnect between what is being taught in college and what is expected of you in the industry. So about this talk is non-exhaustive, which means I'll be trying to teach you and bits and pieces of author different things. I won't cover everything that's in author development that's impossible to do in a 45-minute talk. So you're going to lots and lots of concepts. Very little code. You don't need to take notes, slides are up already, or the link I gave up to the page that after the talk. The idea is to have meet before solutions. Instead of just me talking about, okay, this is how we do it, I first tell you of a problem that we face or why a particular solution is required before telling you the solution exists. Okay, so let's do a Q&A thing. And this is what I really try to tell everyone who's getting into software development. Breadth first learning. It's very nice to have a depth of expertise. For example, my expertise is in development. So I really love machine learning, I really love the web. However, I try to keep a breadth of knowledge, which means I have a moving area around which I can work. So for example, I know lots about JavaScript, I know Rails, I know PHP, I know lots of other, I know a lot of security. So the idea is you have a working knowledge of a lot of different fields at the same time while specializing a particular field. So you might call yourself a Ruby programmer, you might call yourself, okay, I like to work with other level code. At the same time, have a breadth of knowledge, which means you have even if you, let's say you're just doing C-based when you're working on kernel, you'll always be working on kernel, so it's always nice to know about things like GTK or QT, which are like auxiliary things that you can learn by doing C-based development. So these are things that will always help you, and the knowledge that you learn in any of these related fields, for example, anything that I learn in security field, helps me back when I'm working in web development, and vice versa. If I learn about new JavaScript API that's coming up, it helps me back when I go back and try to make some CTFs. Okay? So the idea is that there should be this cross-functional learning between the different topics that you're trying to learn. Am I going too fast? No? Because I need to speak fast as well, so please, you know, just raise your hand and I'll slow down. Okay? So when you start learning software development and you try to teach, learn the theory, you're surrounded by things like waterfall development, agile, and rapid prototyping, extreme programming. How many of you have heard of these terms? Yeah. Okay. How many of you understood these terms? Okay. So this is what if you try and study a software development course in college, that's what they teach you. And I found that all to be, you know, really scary. So this is the thing. I've read all of these about a lot of these, and what I figured out is the thing that you need to focus on is the software itself, the piece of code that you're working on, the software that you're making, whether it be a Perl, whether it be a web application, whether it be a website, or whether from JavaScript, Node, it doesn't matter. So I'm going to ask Perl a question, what is the most important characteristic of the piece of software that you're writing? What do you think is the most important thing for a piece of software?
Bug free.
What is?
Optimized code,
so it should run fast.
Design must be good.
Design must be good.
Efficient.
It should be efficient. It should serve the purpose. That is the first and important thing. It should be correct. So the idea is it should be doing what it's supposed to do. There should be no side effects.
Yeah.
If it's supposed to, you know, delete a file, it should just delete the file, not erase the entire hard disk. It should be secure. Right? When you talk about security, there are three terms that come up. The definition of security that should be confidential, it should maintain confidentiality, which means that nobody, if it's a message between Alice and Bob, Charlie should be deleted. It should be integrity, which means that the message should be tampered with, and if it's tampered with, you should know. It should be available, which means somebody should be able to take it out and, you know, turn away the message in mid-place. For example, the Docker tags. If you're doing a Docker tag against a website, it's gone now and it's no longer available. It should be available. It should be scalable.
That's also a good thing.
The foremost thing that I keep ending is that it should be correct. Otherwise, there's no use of that software. Nobody's gonna ever use it. It's not working as it's expected to work. By available, I mean it should be market, not in development. This is another one of the things you learn about. So you could make the world's best software for 2 years and release it 2 years late in the market and lose. This is what has happened to a lot of companies in the past. This is not something you want to do. So it's nice to ship it as fast as possible. It should be usable. So even if you're writing a kernel level code, usability matters. It's just usability has different definitions and different skills. For example, if you're writing a web application, usability is in the terms of, okay, is it usable to the end customer? Is he taking the steps as required? Is he able to understand what the website is supposed to do? But if you're writing a kernel level code, the usability in that sense would be the API that you're giving to the end user using them. Are these good APIs? Are these maintainable? Do these APIs make sense to the person who's writing code using them? Complexity. Software should be as simple as possible. There should be no needless complexity in the code. You shouldn't be just using a design pattern because you like it. I have made that mistake in the past. I learned about things in factory pattern, I was like, oh, and soft function chaining, I was like, yes, let's use it everywhere. It doesn't work out. It doesn't. I'm not even sure it brings you needless complexity. It's a bad way to write code. It should be maintainable again. So the next person who comes in the code and sees the code should, you know, run the tracks after you and try to get it after you wrote it. That's a very good test of when you write maintainable code. Always assume that you're writing code as if it will be written by a psychotic sociopath. Okay?
And he knows your address.
Another thing is similar related code is always. If you are looking at code you wrote 6 months ago and you are not qualified by it, you will do something wrong. Our field is very fast evolving. So you should, between us and the 6 months, you should be looking at your code as shitty. If you are not, you are not learning. Okay? So, if I am talking about all these things, how do you, you know, these are the things we need to put in our software. How do we make sure that we are putting these things in our software? So, these are a few posters one of our friends made. The first one says that better than perfect, which means release as fast as you can. It's nice to have a piece of code that is out there in the world rather than something that's coming out 2 months later. Okay? Stay focused and keep shipping. I can give you AI files on these posters and on them. And this is the most important one. So the thing I call a library like is something about iterative development. And unlike other things like waterfall and agile and scrum, the word and the term itself makes sense to me. When I say iterative development, it means you're making software in iterations. So you first experiment, you fail, you learn, and you repeat. That's the basic mantra of iterative development. So the idea is you're making a piece of code in small iterations, which means that let's say you're planning to launch a rocket. If you're SpaceX, okay, and you want to launch a rocket to the Mars, you don't start in making the rocket to Mars straight away and wait 10 years till it's done. What you instead do is you make a lower orbit rocket, you make sure it works, then you make sure that you have landing capabilities on Earth with the rocket, then you amongst humans on low Earth orbit, then you ship to the next station. Then you think about Mars. You don't straight away jump to Mars. Okay? So the idea is to take small steps, learn from your mistakes and smaller steps. Because if you're learning a smaller, if you're making a mistake at a smaller step, it's far more easier to recover. So even if one of the lower orbit projects goes down for space, it's not a big deal. If, however, the first Mars mission fails for them, that will screw up it. And it's the only mission that they're doing. Right? So, how do you really play navigate with orbit into practice? The first thing is launch as soon as possible. Okay? So, another one thing I really like is something called BTD-driven development. Okay? Which says that instead of writing code first, you write a BTD file first. The BTD file gives all the entire spec, it gives all the license, it tells what exactly you're trying to build, and then you write the code. Amazon also does this thing similarly in their internal project. What they do is they write the PR or the press release for the product that they want to release first. So let's say if you're a software developer working at Amazon and you have a really good idea that you think Amazon should be working on. So the developer himself is supposed to write the press release that how this product will look to the customer and the press gets released even before you write the single line of code. Okay, so it's always fun to dive in first and look after code, but the idea is okay, unless you have an idea where you're going, you want to write code. Take user feedback regularly. If you're writing user code for any person, even if meant to be user developer themselves, take feedback regularly, ask people what they're liking, what they're not liking. That's how iteration works. You get feedback from our iteration, we use that, you have to be back. Have frequent deploys, ship regularly, commit frequently, and make sure that vendor push as fast as possible to the server. So if you're writing the app, make sure that you're releasing as soon as possible. So what happens otherwise is, if let's say you build up a queue of 100 commits, then you need to deploy at the same time. Okay, let's say you have a weekly deploy schedule. So what will happen is, every Friday or every Monday or whatever you find, any of these 100 commits might have an issue that you never know of till you release. So all of these will block up together. Instead, as you're releasing frequently, any of the issues will get noticed immediately. And they are easier to look after in a single commit rather than when you're looking at 100 different issues from different commits. Okay? So, ship regularly, that's a really good thing by GitHub. They do like 300 releases every day. Okay? And it may sound insane to you, but it is possible. We do like 5-10 because we have a small team, but it's really possible. If you work at it, it's possible. I would like feedback loop, which means keep asking for feedback and make sure that feedback is used in the next cycle. Okay, yeah. Am I going fast? No? Any questions so far? So the idea was, let's make software development better, let's learn iterative development, and I'll keep jumping topics, okay? So the slide colors are topics. So, can anyone connect these companies? I'm a serial user, I really like brothers. I'm a mom.
PlayStation.
Close. Okay, I'll give you a hint. Now can anyone guess?
Netflix.
No. You have to connect these companies. There's something connecting all of these six companies.
Security.
Security is close. What exactly is security?
Encryption.
Not encryption. All of these six companies will hack.
Yeah. Yes. I think you should update that list.
Yeah. I did last pass. Yeah, I have ideas. I don't think of anything better.
Actually,
no, that's not a giveaway. Nothing except for the acting.
Okay.
So yeah, all these six companies will have not something you'd expect of, you know, things like Sony and RSA security and LastPass. But yeah, that's what happens if you're working in security. So the first thing about software security is on the radio. The things that you usually think work out is not the same for software security. For example, the first thing about software security is, if you're writing a crypto algorithm, you're really wrong. You shouldn't be writing your own crypto algorithm because you don't have the required knowledge. Even if you do write one, you should be a crypto scientist, a PhD scientist who has studied all of the things that have been in crypto for the last 50 years. And after you have done that, you publish a paper. You wait for the industry to attack it. You wait for the academy to attack it, and then probably gets attacked and broken in like 2 years. If it works out for like 5 years, that is when the industry should be adopting it. Because crypto is really sensitive. So you don't buy your own crypto. That's the first loss of security. And the other thing about top security is why it's not driven. It's not technically that the best possible piece of encryption is one that's open. You can be handling your own encryption routine, you can be handling your own crypto, you can handle your own software security things, but they are not good enough if you are scared about opening them. If you have opened them up to the public, that lands out lots of eyeballs, make everyone shallow or something of that sort. Right? As many people are looking at a particular piece of code, the higher chance that a bug will be caught. Okay? So once you open up your encryption, you open up software security details, that's the only time when people start trusting, okay, I believe you, this is how it will work. Because unless I understand how it is working, unless I can proofread it, unless I can check the security of your devices, I won't be trusting it. I shouldn't be trusting it, in fact. Okay? So the best piece of security code that you'll ever see, the things like pirating, right? Are things like SSL. And these things are not proprietary algorithms. Every proprietary algorithm will get hacked. Okay? Unless you publish a paper, and then it will get hacked again. And that is how you iterate. You publish a paper, and then you figure out, okay, this is how somebody attacked my algorithm, and these are the ways I can improve on it. And that is how the world is of security works. Okay? It's also really hard. Normal software development, if you're, let's say, just making a web application or just making a simple Android application, these are things you can sidestep. But if you're trying to work in software security itself, it's really hard. Our team was there for 3 years. The company was introduced in 11 or so, and it was related in 2014. Similarly, Shellshock Vulnerability, you might have heard of it, but the Vulnerability Bash. It was a worldwide, scary thing that's happening, and it was there from 1989 to 2014. That's like 25 years or so, right? And nobody had any clue. Bash is open source, everybody had access to the source code, nobody. Okay? It takes, there's a Google researcher who was working on SSL who figured out Heartbleed, and I'm not sure who figured out Shellshock. But this is a hard domain, and it's also very easy to get wrong. For example, you might introduce a slight patch into something which breaks up an existing piece of code that you've written previously. That's just a general testing. But very often you write a security patch that will introduce any security vulnerability. For example, have you heard of this thing about timing attacks? So what happens is, let's say I'm making a network request and the password is a 32 character string. Okay? I don't know that. So what I do is here is, normally if you're matching, if you're comparing strings in any language, what happens is, the string matching will be dependent on the length of the string, the time to match the regular string. Okay? So if it's a 1000 character string, it will take, if I send a 1000 character string, it will take time to entirely count to the string, right? And if I send a 500 the time will be half, right? So what I essentially do is I send I send a one character string. Okay, I get the response. I check the time of the response. I do it half the time. Okay, so I have a mean of how much time does it take. I do the same for 2, 3, 4, 5, and I notice that anything above 1000 is getting printed off. Okay, is not fit after 1000 characters. So I know, okay, the password is not 1000 characters. Now what I do is I start permutating the entire of that string, character by character. So the first character is matched first, which means if I fill up the first 500 characters correctly, the string will take the same amount of time. The time, this is what is known as timing attack. And these are the really little things that you never think about when doing string comparisons. Okay? If you're just comparing two strings, you don't think about, okay, are the strings equal in length? Are they not? Is there possible timing attack? But these are things you need to look into if you're writing secure code. Okay? It also needs just one dedicated attacker. Unlike a normal physical security, where you might have to think about different things. In digital security, with almost everyone has access to your machine, yeah, because it's on the internet, it just needs one person across the internet to screw up things. Okay? It could be a person in China, it could be someone in India, it could be anywhere. You don't know. So it's hard. So how do we start? How do you start to, get into this really scary field of software security? It's actually really easy. The first thing is use deep crypto hashing passwords. If you've all, if you're ever writing code, actually, with passwords, use something called decrypt. Don't use MD5 token. Don't use SHA-1, it'll break in 2 years. Use decrypt. That's the first piece of advice. Now, software release privileges. It's a very good software security principle, which says that any piece of code that you write should be able to do the least possible amount of damage. Okay? So, it should be running with the least possible privileges that it can have. For example, if you're serving, if you're doing a WordPress blog, and that is only a read-only blog, let's say, you're not anymore posting to it regularly. What about just making the database user read-only? So the user can only read from the database, and as a result, nobody can ever hack into the system because they won't be able to write anything. Right? That's a very simple thing that you do, right? Similarly, even if you're writing DNS utilities, don't run with root unless you actually need to. Run with, for example, things like Apache, they start at root, but talk to nobody privileges as soon as they can. Because they don't want to affect the system. If your Apache server gets hacked, it won't have any effect because it's running at nobody. It doesn't have any privileges to anything in the system. Other than what you specifically gave it. Okay, leave these files in the file and don't touch anywhere else. Okay, that's how software security, the principle of least privileges works. Never trust user input, emphasis on never trust user input. User input is malicious unless you have checked it thoroughly. It's always malicious. You don't assume that just because the user is an administrative user, it'll be fine. Or user is local. The user on a desktop, it'll be fine. We never do this. You always check user input for correctness. Read and understand the OWASP doctrine. This is a really easy way to start. We started with web security in general. OWASP is, I don't remember the form, but offensive security project, I think, something like that. So, they do this thing called top 10 bug release in 2013, 2015. The top 10 is usually SQL injection, things like CSR attacks, XSS attacks, which you can get started easily if you just go to OWASP top 10. Try something like CTF. How many of you have heard of CTF? One. Okay. So a CTF is a capture the flag contest where you are essentially hacking into someone's machine. Okay. Usually it's in the form of challenges, which means that somebody set up a hacking challenge which you can only hack by a certain vulnerability in their code. And it's if you've done computer programming or if you've done online math challenges and things like that, it's the exact same thing but for security. So try to do a lot of good dictionary of CTFs, even Google one. So you can try these out. Many of them are on there all the time. So just search for baby CTFs and you'll get some of them. Understand vulnerabilities and keep up. That's continuous target software development. You need to be continuously learning new things. So keep up with the vulnerabilities that are coming up. So if hardly come out recently, you should look at how it works, why it works, and things like that. Okay. This is the security side. Agnostic development. This is the Wikipedia definition that says denoting a really hardware. Essentially, cross platform is the closest meaning it gets from Wikipedia. But the idea is you should always be writing code in whichever way is best for that particular piece of code. For example, if you're interested in the should be doing C++ or maybe not Go. If you're doing one-time script, maybe root in Perl, maybe root in Bash. If you're doing machine learning, Python would be a good choice because of the existing, ecosystem of things around machine learning have been done in Python. So the things like SciPy, NumPy, and other things, which help you do machine learning in Python. You might be able to do the same things and Ruby as well, but you won't have that ecosystem and you'll be using out a lot of things. So it makes sense to do this machine learning thing in Python. If you're doing iOS development, you can't do it in anything other than Swift Object SE. You might be able to figure out ways, but better if you do it in this, these things. Okay? Similarly, if you're doing Android, you need to pick up Java. So the common thing is choose the right tool for the job. Don't,
Can we do iOS and Android development in CSS, HTML, JavaScript?
Yes, you can. I really like to do that because I suit myself. But the idea is if you're working on a platform, if you really want to use the things of the platform, you need to go to integrate. You can't use things like features and all those things. You might get right for Lua, but I don't think it's a good solution right now.
What is Ruby good for?
That might be a good time to do it. Ruby is really good for writing clean and elegant.
I love
Ruby. I haven't Ruby much for elegant, but Ruby I like a lot of text on Ruby. I also write a lot of episodes in Ruby. Not always, but I really like Ruby for text. So I can pretty much use Ruby anywhere. But for example, if I'm writing a small one script, I do it in Bash. I won't take a Ruby just for the use case. Okay, so that's the idea. Choose the right tool for the job. It's not necessary that you must, you're being forced to use a shell. If you're, let's say, learning something in Ruby and you want to implement a shell script in Ruby, you can do that. But always make sure that you're aware of the trade-off that you're doing. You should be aware, okay, I should be using shell here, but I have decided specifically to not use Bash here. Okay. The next thing, see an open source development. Another question. Many people generous programming language, so you can't deny that. I knew that was the use it open. Yeah, I knew that was gonna come up, so I'm prepared for that. C sharp is now open. Just for the last time we ended up. But yeah, pretty much every language, every generous programming language that you think of is now open. It's really a cool thing. In a world where we are surrounded with proprietary software, and it's really cool thing that all the programming languages are somehow open. Okay, so these are languages. Metro, Emacs, my bad. You can, you know, punch me with a knife after a moment. This is what we use, and these are standards. A very important thing is people remember the software that we use, the language that we use are open, the tools that we use are open, but people often forget the specs and the SIP, and you know, things like RSCs and HTTP and all these really cool protocols and specifications that are built out in the open. For example, the HTML5 spec. You can go back and read the discussions that went before even an input type is equal to time was implemented in the browser. Right? These things don't come up by themselves. So there are a lot of people working on this, and this is why we need open systems. For example, if let's say Microsoft has its own Microsoft does have its own actually BMP format, right? I'm not sure if it's proprietary anymore. But what if every, you know, every device that you own had its own proprietary image format? Would the web work as we know it today? If we didn't have things like JPG and PNG? No, right? If we didn't have something like HTTP? None of us would be here. We wouldn't have internet. Okay, so this is something I really like about the open source movement. It's not related exactly, but it's actually related because these things are made out in the open. Okay, so you need to, even if you're writing something like specification for API, can you make it more encompassing and make sure that it gets promoted to the specific of its own? These are things you can often worry about. So, another thing I want to touch on is the repository open source and free software. This is a very good post on the topic by Richard Stallman, which goes into the difference why open source is missing the point. But the idea is that the goal of the difference. So when you're saying I support open source, you're essentially saying that I prefer software becomes more robust by being open. Okay? Mozilla, when it came out, that was the kind of thing about the Firefox, that by being open, people could produce better software. And that allowed people, because Chromium adopted the same one. Okay? On the other hand, when you're talking about something like free software, the idea is your software may be better, even if it's open source, but if it doesn't respect my freedom, I'm not going to use it. So, a very easy way to show the difference, because very often, if it's free, it means it's open source as well. However, it was usually might not be true. So, very good example is Mozilla is introducing DRM nuggets in Firefox. Okay, which means that a software job will be put in a router, which will be entertaining, decrypting movies on Netflix. This doesn't work. This works against the philosophy of free software. However, open source movement says, okay, it's fine, they will be able to produce a better software as a result. Which is demonstrably true. You'll be able to use Netflix across anywhere in the world, just in Firefox. Okay, that's a cool thing to have. At the same time, it transfer my key and say, I'll have a further talk and you have no idea what I want to do on a system. So that's where, commonly routine over some city software turn up and emerge. But there's something just to be damaged here. You should really pinpoint and say, okay, I'm doing free software only, I'm fully, I'm not supporting Firefox. But something cool to know. How do you get started with open source? Okay, the first thing is don't get scared. We have been hundreds of GitHub open projects these days. Even small baby fixes are appreciated. So try that. Participate in community that values this principle. Thankfully for all of you, geeks don't care about community. Okay? Which means you're in a good place. This is not true for everyone who's doing software. Okay? There are even studies colleges where they have no point of community because they don't know anyone in the circle who believes in these things, who works on these software programs. So, if you don't have a community, earlier if you do, try to join an online conversation, try to be active on hacking, try to be active on things like Stack Overflow. Okay? Participate in any that you can, fix issues, help out people, even helping out people on IRC is a good thing. Okay. Moving on, it's now free and open source. Any questions?
No.
Is it very boring?
How does the IRC helping out people on IRC go?
If you are, let's say, if I'm not even contributing to a particular project, but you know how it works, you can just go over there and help out people.
Okay.
Because if you're not actively coding, you're still helping out the project in a certain manner, right?
Okay.
Just hop, for example, I know ways I hop on and they have to build and help out people. Okay, they are already involved, can I solve it? But even if you're not active on IRC, they can answer questions with Jack also. If you're helping out the community.
Okay. So, Red Hat is also Linux,
yeah.
But it is paid.
Yes. Okay, support is paid.
Yeah, so what is that?
Support is paid.
Support is paid. They're not paying you, they're not asking money for giving you Red Hat. They're asking money for helping you with these issues in Red Hat.
Okay, so their administrator would come and.
Yeah, be Red Hat. So similarly, CentOS is an open source version of Red Hat. It has all the same libraries, it has a stack and things like that. But essentially, you can use CentOS if you want to get Red Hat. So, I assume all of you is Red here.
It's pretty awesome.
Yes, that's the first lecture we take at our college. And learn Git. Okay, how do you use multi-real? I won't judge. I prefer Git. But yeah, you can use pretty much anything as long as it's version controlled. And why should you use? You should be pretty much aware of these things by now. You can track it easily. It's far more easier than making zip files, which is what designers everywhere say do. Okay? And a really cool thing is know where the bubbles and videos can be going to pass the person who videos it. A good thing about feeling well. Okay? So, I'm halfway through and okay. Test your development. How many of you know tests? You people? How many of you written tests yourself? Okay, so the idea is okay, I go through this by example code. Let's say this is a simple function in JavaScript. It's a basement function, it just splits by slashes, takes out the last piece and returns it. So base name of something like etc password would just return password. Okay? This is clear enough, right? Nothing fancy. So this is what you wrote the piece of code to be used for. Okay, you thought, okay, I'll be using it for file parts. Okay. And that is what it's being used for. Until somebody came up one day, saw your code, and decided, okay, this function works with this as well, right? It's a perfectly legal use case for this particular function. You can use base name on twitter.com/elonmusk and it will give you elonmusk. So you're like, okay, I can get the new username from the same URL. I'll be working fine. So then a third person comes up and he sees, okay, this function is being used in the fragment somewhere in JavaScript. There is being used to check for Twitter URLs and return the Twitter username. And he notices that, sometimes people are submitting things like just twitter.com/elonmusk and you don't want that, doesn't want that to work. So he just adds a new code saying, okay, if it's not HTTP, let's throw an error. Okay, let's ignore HTTP for now. But this is what he wrote. He said, okay, out of an error, he got an exception in his piece of code wherever it was using base name. And it was all fine. we dropped off that enormous noise and error. And except, what happens to this? Right? This piece of code is still somewhere. It was still being used against the password, but it's gonna throw an error. Right? Because you're not starting with HTTP, that's what the function is now supposed to do. So, how do you prevent something like this? Okay? You write something called a test. So, this is a very simple tool in test, which just says if the base name, it's just a, you know, multiple mapping between what's the input I get and what's the output I should return of a particular function. You just say, okay, if the base name is not a return password, let's return false, and then we can check it somewhere in a testing framework, for example. Every time you commit a piece of code, it'll check, it will run this particular function, and it'll say it must check that it returns true. Once that particular error was added, the function starts running false, or at least it throws an error. Okay? And at that point, you catch it. So, this is something we call regression testing. As soon as something breaks, you'll be aware of it because it won't be a passing the test anymore. That's the easiest way to convince someone of, you know, writing this. You can write code, it'll work. You change code 5 days from now, it'll break something you wrote 5 days ago, and you won't be aware of it. That's why write tests. So, in testing, there are lots of different things. First is do automated testing. Manual testing is something you should, you can be doing, but let's start with automated testing. Okay, it's a really easy way. Almost every framework from every language, from C to even Shell, has testing frameworks. Use them. Then there's this thing called TDD, proper test yourself. It means that you'll be writing tests first, which is something you should read up on your own. Okay. Then there's things like regression testing, which means you're testing for paths that might be introduced between the last commit and this commit and so on. So you're aware of where things have broken, and you check your commit and say, okay, this particular test is not running. You say that, okay, this test is not a particular function, and then you can see, check back and see, okay, where was this particular function that you last, and so on. Then you can have the unit testing, which means you test things in little silos, which means if you have one particular class or a particular function, that's the only particular function that you're testing at a time, and you don't worry about its other dependencies. So that's the only piece of code that you've got. So, for example, this would have been a good unit test, it's only checking one particular measure. On the other hand, you have things like integration test, which means you're testing things in its entirety. For example, for a website, for a particular website, we run an entire Selenium framework, which actually goes and clicks the mouse and says, click on the button and make sure everything is working fine, as it is supposed to do. So, what it'll do is, it'll actually fill up the login form and click on submit and make sure that the user is redirected to the login page. So, that is something called an integration test. Okay, we are testing things in its entirety as how it is supposed to work, if I make any code, what is the response I get, instead of just one particular piece of code. So, both things are good, it depends on what kind of way you're working and what you're reading you want. It helps you catch bug, unit testing helps you write better code, integration testing tests your entire code. Okay? So, this is about test and API. How many of you have used an API before? Any sort of API? Okay. So, when we talk about how many of you have heard this term NIH? No one. It's called, not invented here. There's something called an NIH syndrome that is very popular term in Google, because Google likes to, you know, recreate everything on its own. It makes sense for them because at the scale they are running, they can't really use custom, they can't really use off-the-shelf solutions. But at normal scale of at which you're usually working, let's say it's going to display a map on a web page, okay? And you want to draw over that particular map, and you want to draw pins on it, okay? And you want to measure distance between two points, okay? And you want to get geolocation data as well as when you drop a ship for you with a particular tennis drop. You shouldn't be writing your own thing, you should be using Google Maps API. You can be writing your own thing, but there's also a trade-off. If your product is the Google Maps API, and let's say you're working at Mapbox, then it makes perfect sense. However, if your code, if the piece of code you're writing is something like it's a Google, you know, it's just trying to schedule a drop between two points. You shouldn't be writing your own app framework, you should be using Google Maps, which is what Google does. Right? Similarly, if you want to, you know, check the current latest news and do it to sentiment analysis over it. You shouldn't get your own dedicated work to scrape this from 100 different news websites and parse it and then make sure and run up your end and so that. Very easy to get started, we just simply take the for a search term, for example, and then run your analysis and go over it. Okay? Similarly, if you want to send lots of different things, and you want to make sure that they're not flat, you want to use a template thing, it should be sent within a few minutes. It shouldn't be like taking your own mail thing. You can be, but it's better to use time to focus on the problem that you're working on. If your problem isn't email delivery, clearly you should be using email API. So, when you talk about ETA, there's this cool thing called REST which allows inter-machine communication. Okay? So that's the ETA definition of REST. So what I like to call is API over HTTP, which means you have an application programming interface running on top of HTTP, which is REST. Or in other words, it allows you a really cool way to, you know, do object-oriented programming over HTTP. It sounds weird, but the basic principle behind something called REST is that every URL is an object. Okay? URLs are technically called a resource, but for a simple principle, let's assume it's an object. What all things, if you have an object programming, you will think of things like cars. Okay? This is how everyone has been taught object-oriented programming. You have a car, and it has wheels, it can drive. Okay? Similarly, this is a photo. It's not a URL. This is a photo. Let's assume this is a photo object. This is a photo object. Okay? When you make a GET request, if you've done some thing on HTTP, you should know what a GET request is. If you're making a GET request to a photo, you're seeing a photo. If you're making a POST request, you're posting a photo, which means creating a photo. If you're putting, if you're making a GET request to the same URL, to the same resource, it means you're editing a photo. If you're making a DELETE request, if you then you get a DELETE. Okay? And then you can have things like but let's say if you have slash photo slash 20, this is a photo, and you want to get a histogram for that particular photo, then you just use slash photo slash 23 slash histogram. That will give you all the histogram data for that particular photo, let's say. How can you edit a histogram? Not really, you need to edit a photo first, right? So the put request for slash histogram should be valid. I haven't made a photo upload thing, but I know how it should work. And as a result, let's say if I make such a photo upload thing with a histogram thing, anybody who ever sees my API will be able to easily figure out how it works. Okay, that slash histogram. I can't post to slash histogram to get any photo. I can only post to slash photos and get any photo. It's a way for machines to talk, for example. So even if you have a web server giving you Bitcoins, you can write a API on top of it. And then another some person can, you know, running a machine in a restaurant, can you talk to that Bitcoin API and then exchange money? You can have ATMs running on top of this. So that's the general idea behind REST. It allows machines communicating with each other without human intervention. It's a brilliant solution to a real problem, which is how to make machines talk to each other. That is an easily addressable way for everyone in the programming language to understand. That's why REST is really, really important thing. If all of your teams need to be like straight left. Okay, so this is something from the communications of ACM 1986. This is, how many of you have heard of this guy? Donald Knuth. He's a very famous computer scientist. He wrote The Art of Computer Programming, which is like a Bible by Watson's. Okay, so in 1986, he was asked to pen a list column on literary programming, that is the topic he used. So, as a to demonstrate the literary programming pattern, he decided to pick a problem, which is a very fairly standard problem. Read a file of text, determine the most frequently used words, and print out a sorted list of these words along with the frequencies. It's a fairly standard computer programming. How you do it? Fairly easy. You just pick them out, pick a frequency table, and put out the result. Okay? So, not only did he do this, and what he did was, he wrote a 10-page program in using literary programming, which was written in a language called Web, which he wrote himself. The language is based in Pascal. It uses a custom data structure. It is a really awesome piece of code. Okay? People saw it and went, oh, they were like, okay, literary programming is cool, I should really get started using that. And then, I'm sure nobody has heard of this guy. Okay, the McElroy. He used to work at Bell Labs. He was one of the people who worked in Linux. So, in the next edition of Communications of ACM, he wrote a counter editorial on the article. And he gave six lines of issue, the same talk. Okay, and this is the six lines of issue. If you're used to bash Unix, you should be figuring it out. The first line is PR, which is the target program in Unix, which allows you to remove non-word characters. It does a complement. So anything that is not capital A to Z or small A to Z gets removed. Gets converted and it is in the fashion. The second thing is the other converted into the lowercase. So everything that is capital A to Z gets into the small A to Z. Next thing is the other starts to take words together. So if double dose here, both of them get together because it's now sorted list. Next thing is just like remove duplicates and includes account. That's what unique command does. That she's just including account. Next thing is just like it sorts in the reverse order numerically because it has the counts and it's got the reverse counts and it's in the reverse order. The last thing is just to quit after reading $1.9, which is the first argument passed to this shell script. Okay, it's a 6 lines obviously, but the same thing that $1.9 does in 10 pages. And that is in essence the Unix philosophy. Every program, no, not with this, this is not the Unix philosophy, this is the Unix philosophy. Small is beautiful. Make each program do one thing. So this is really cool site for one thing kind of merging, which keeps a list of, it's a Tumblr blog, which posts really cool small nifty programs that do one thing and just do one thing with it. For example, it could be a tool that helps you take screenshots on your Mac. Okay, or it could be a tool that helps you take a screenshot and upload it to pop-ups as easily as possible. The other thing about Unix philosophy is that it allows you to make composable programs. So for example, the pipe, which is probably the best invention that Unix came out with. Okay, it allows you to use text as an interface between two different programs. So anything that can be sorted can be passed on to Unix. Right? And this allows you to make small programs that initially write together and will really change. Okay? And this is what was happening. And this is a quote from, I think, 2004 or something, when everything was implementing its own email program. So Opera had its main thing, Netscape had its main thing, even Discord had its main thing for a while, I think. Firefox had its main thing. So everything was kind of being made. Thankfully, we're getting back to smaller programs today, because mostly due to Android and iOS and mobile platforms, which help you, you know, give you really small tiny apps. Then you do just one thing, and that's how you should be writing programs. That do just one thing and do it really well. And finally, I wrote a blog post yesterday about, because this is a very common question I keep getting, you know, from people at school, from other people who are even working at other places, that how do they get a great software, how do they get started in application development, things like that. So I wrote a list finally, because I was essentially, you know, copying basic responses at this point, because a lot of people ask me this. So the first thing is joining community. You've already done that step. Congratulations, you're a really good community. Second thing is contribute to open source. Okay. I'll only expand on the aspects. Write code also publicly. The, you know, writing code that is not public should be an exception, not the norm. Okay, so try to put everything you do on GitHub. Nobody's ever gonna look at it, but just in case, it might help someone. Even if it doesn't, I might go through it and, you know, learn something. Do tech talks. Public speaking, especially in tech, really helps you a lot because it's your team. If you're talking about something, you need to know it better than the people who are listening to you. And to do that, you need to do a certain amount of homework. And you need, so it helps, it's a way of forced learning, right? You force yourself to give a talk, and then just because you're giving a talk, you're like, okay, I should know these things because there should be a person who already knows about this more than me. So, learn more languages is a really important thing as well. Don't restrict yourself to being a new programmer, a speech programmer, or a Python programmer, because every time you learn a new language, similar to how you learn a new second language in the real world, if you learn English or if you learn Spanish, just learning Spanish will give you different ways of saying things. Okay, it gives you a different way of saying it. Similarly, if you're learning a second programming language, it also tells you a lot about the different patterns that are available in that particular language. For example, if you have Dell or Ruby, meta programming is really big in Ruby. However, it's not that big in PHP or JavaScript at this point. But these things will carry on even if you're writing JavaScript code. Maybe you can write a particular piece of code better only using meta programming in JavaScript. And to do that, you should be aware of how meta programming works and all those things, and you only get aware of it by writing Ruby. Concepts matter, this is what Santosh also talked about. You should always be aware of one layer below that which you are working. This is a really good code. So, if you're working on that, you should be aware of HTTP works. If you're working on security and let's say SMTP protocols, you should be aware how TCP/IP works. Okay, if you're working on compilers, you should be aware of SMTP works and how kind of works. So, you should always be looking at one layer below it and go as deep as you can. So, ship products. Nothing really matters unless you really put a piece of code that's working out in the world. Have side projects, this is also very important. If you have good side projects of your own, there is no dearth of jobs for you. Okay, I've been offered jobs just because of my side projects to people who are like, okay, I don't want to take that interview, just come and join me. Okay, because I've seen a code on Twitter, and it's good enough for me, just come. This just not happening, not just me, a lot of other people I know as well. So, really good side projects really help managing it. Read technical books whenever you can. So, always have one book that you're reading at a time. One particular technical book, it doesn't have to be in the particular domain you're working on, it could be something else. If you're working right, you could read a book or a movie, it doesn't matter, but read technical books. Okay? This was my website. So I'm writing a book. I'm still writing a book. You can read it if you want to. It also is an extension of this talk, so it goes into different things like testing and how she works and different other things in software development that you should be aware of. But it doesn't go into depth. So yeah, let's do Q&A later then. You can go to this link. This is where there are a lot of links about everything I covered in the talk today, including the link to the final blog post about what to do to get better software development. Yeah, that's it. Thank you. Questions?
You said we should go one layer below on what you're working, right? So how do you go one layer below mobile development?
You can look at the Android APIs itself.
Yeah.
Because Android is open source, you should be aware of how Android works internally. That's a good way.
Any other problem?
Let's say you're working on app for that uses GPS. Okay. How you might be getting numbers in GPS itself. Okay. And you're not getting it to work properly across different devices. You're not aware of the time lag involved. Okay. Instead of just looking at the API and using it as is, you can maybe look at the Android source code itself and figure out how it's working in the internals. Okay. And even things like, and once you start looking at the Android code itself, you'll be aware of the many patterns and many ideas that Android is used for mobile development. For example, these things will help you to save battery. Right, you won't be aware of these patterns till you look at the Android code itself.
Okay.
That's one way. I'm not sure how you go about that in iOS. But maybe you can at least look at the toolchain itself. So, very easy for this is if you're working with Eclipse programmers, they're not taking Java programmers anymore. Because they only are aware of how Eclipse works. They know, okay, I click on this button, I go to build and it builds. They're not aware that it's internally calling Java C.
Okay.
So, if you're looking at the entire toolchain and how your program is being built, you'll be able to easier, better debug issues that you're facing.
How do you go around the learning design patterns?
Read the Gamma 4. The Gamma 4 is a really good book. Martin Fowler and Cheer Beagle. That's the Bible of design patterns. Other than that, read books for design patterns specifically. There are two really good books that I suggest you every software developer. The first is something called Don't Make Me Think. So, this is the first book I recommend to everyone. This is not a book on programming, this is not a book on development, so this is the book I recommend everyone. This is a book on web usability. It talks about how to write software that's usable for people. Okay? You won't become a better programmer as a result of it, but you'll give you better design experience for users. And that is something I feel is very much important. So it's a very short book, it's like hardly 80 pages or so, but it's a really good book. The second book I suggest is The Pragmatic Programmer. Read these two books and then maybe you can go to other books. There's a really good reading list by Jeff Atwood, Coding Mother, on books that developers should read. You can go to that list. It's linked down on the blog post.
Having signed for this, you still think you use a better one because the list you're giving is so exhaustive, right? I mean, how can you do everything at the same time? There has some amount of free time, you know, you're saying to stay updated, contribute open source, have signed for this, and so.
Yeah, but no, really, you know, your cycle is automatically, you should be open source.
Yeah, that's okay, right. You know, but that's
the contributing part of it. What if, let's say, you're using whatever framework on your side project, you can contribute back to it because you're running it and seeing and acting on to do.
Okay, by the way, talking about the subject. So he actually contacted us because he wanted to be a mentor at this school. So he's unofficially a mentor.
Okay.
So I got him for JS school because of that. I told him I can get you to Bangalore. I don't have the money to get you here, but if you can give a talk at JS school, I can get you to Bangalore. So that's how he landed up here.
Wow.
Then, so he told me when I first spoke to him that all the students must write. So he's interested in JS school. In fact, he was even reviewing his that JS school Argentina. He's from Argentina. He's from San Francisco. He's originally in Argentina. So the Argentina is also a kind of a country like India, not America, you know, where things in school concept to be used. So he said something similar. He said all the students should write a blog post and blog about their work. Okay, and that's another thing also. So you said that how am I going to get time to do all this? I said, that's not all, you also have to write a blog post.
Yes.
You not only have to do all that, but you also have to read them. See, it's not about like the two books we have recommended, both are good books. But, so, you know, it's not about, now we also recommend some books. And probably we have only books recommended to go to our. So, this will be added to our recommendation list. Right, on our wiki. Mm-hmm. If you go there, there are other people who have come and recommended other books. Right. So, you see, one thing you should be constantly doing as a programmer all through your life, not at least, is to be reading one book all the time. Right? So you should be reading one book continuously all the time. Initially, you read the language you're learning right now. You're learning JavaScript, then you read another JavaScript, then you read another JavaScript book. Like that, you have to, until you really feel like you have a JavaScript master. So that's one book you have to read. Continue reading the JavaScript book. Then over and above, you have got to master programming. So that's where these books come. So you have to, so it doesn't mean that you should read, he's not telling you to read this book tomorrow. Maybe you will read it in 3 months, or maybe you will read it in 6 months. Doesn't matter. What he's saying is that these are the books which should be read by every program. So you won't be able to read it today or tomorrow. Or even maybe you will read it next year.
See, I think it's like made in this profession, it's not a short term thing.
Yeah. So
this is the long term thing.
But the question of being neither the jack of or the master of one thing is like very.
You should be a master of one.
We have doubt about that. I mean, deep school is not about being a jack of all trades. No, you get to be a jack of all trades, you get to the numbers. And then you won't become a jack of all trades here. You'll be only focused on one language. That too, and we set you on a path to become a master of one.
The point is, you should be aware of everything else.
And not only that, you have to master one language, then only you will be able to, after you master one language, then only you will be able to, move on to the next language. There is no point, if I was interviewing somebody for the job, and one guy came and told me, look, I only know one language, I know JavaScript, that's it. But I've interviewed him, he knows everything is thorough about JavaScript. Fine. Another guy, I know five languages, I know Java, JavaScript, Python, and what else, I don't know. But you know the five languages, and see, when I ask him questions from each language, turns out he got snatching this, snatching of this. I will take that Java, even if I want a Python guy, even this guy knows that, I will take that guy who knows JavaScript, who mastered JavaScript, because I know once you master one language, you can easily master another language. But a jack of all trades still has to go through the process of mastering the language again. Doesn't matter. Right? So, there is no point taking. You have to be a master of one language, then you move on to other languages. But these are all things which, so all these books and all, basically you have to have read them. Got it? Gimpul is only about getting from that. You understood, okay, the concept, yes, I can do it also.
This is my problem. So you should have a depth of expertise. And you should have a breadth of knowledge. So even if you're a Python programmer, you should be aware of JavaScript and what it does and how it works.
Right. So that way you're fortunate, you have to
be sure. Yes, exactly. That is why communities matter, because you have this thing called pattern learning. So even if you're working only in Python, you have this hundred people working on other languages and you get to cross them. That is why communities
matter. So these schools you cross them, which you not find in other schools. So they all teach you only one language at a time. We have talks on the assembly stuff, but you guys know about JavaScript. JavaScript guys who know about. In fact, everybody in this school knows the Lisp. I mean, they don't program Lisp, but they know how Lisp works, how Lisp expressions work. You know, so those things will happen.
Any other questions?
Any challenges you face at Razorpay that maybe we really rethink your learning or something that changed your
In taking a payment gateway, there will not feel any technical challenges as such. The API is a straightforward for us. What's important for me is to make APIs that are really good, which means really efficient APIs, which are understandable and easy to use, to make easy to use API and integrations. The hard part is not even integrating with backs and master guidance and all those things. The hard part is figuring out the agreements and getting people on board and talking to them.
And this is the legal
stuff. Legal stuff. The legal stuff comes out really hard.
Another program.
Something in JavaScript though, it's really hard for you to hand out SDKs to people, a piece of JavaScript code that doesn't have any side effects on their existing piece of code. So what we are doing earlier was, we have a JavaScript integration, which shows you a pop-up form on your website, right? This... So this is a very fairly simple idea now. Earlier we wanted to allow merchants, give merchants the chance to customize this particular form, change styles if they wanted to. So I decided to use the dev instead of an iframe. And it's a very simple decision to either use a dev or iframe, because iframe can't be styled very bad. It can't be studied. So I used this, and as it turns out, there's a hell lot of studies that just enroach. So even if we decide to use subclass everything under .rfp slash, all of our classes use .rfp dash, and it might seem it works on other things, but some merchants of style, let's say star font something, and it screws up with us. That's an interesting piece. So we shifted to iframes later on. Numbers is fun,
that's it. You should offer your own set of themes.
Yeah, that's what we are working on. So now we have a I'm not sure if it's live anywhere, but we'll eventually already change the color, the base color that will be everywhere.
Oh,
just one thing. Okay, I don't know how to stop this.
Okay, I got just one last question.
Okay, one question.
Yeah.
How does commit programming help you? Does it help you at all become a good programmer?
Okay, so in my college, commit programming is really big because a lot of people they have a really good active programming culture over there. Commit programming for people who are using PC and all those things. And every of my commit programming friends tells me that commit programming is really good for one particular thing, and that is getting me jobs. Okay, once you get the job, it doesn't tend to help you out that much. But however, learning object programming itself is a really good thing. Because you understand a lot of things about writing efficient code. However, the code that you write isn't maintainable at all. So there are trade-offs if you learn from. So ideally you should use both. So I did object programming as well. Although I'm like the weird guy who does object programming in Ruby. So it's really fun though. But yeah. So I try to do both.